Oh, you guys can hear.
All right. We can still close the door now on your. Get started. Thank you so much for coming out on this rainy Sunday to attend the 6th Congressional Candidate Forum. This is the first time that all 8 Democratic challengers are together. So thank you very much, and thank all of you who are here today. I'm Corey Houston, one of the founders of People Over Party, a grassroots group that promotes civic participation. I would like to thank our co-sponsors, Coalition for a Better Illinois 6th, and helping us plan today's event. A few notes about today's format. To allow us to ask as broad a variety of questions as possible, while still hearing multiple perspectives on each topic, each question will be directed to 4 of the 8 candidates. To ensure an even distribution of speaking opportunities, each candidate has picked a number between 1 and 8 to determine their speaker ID. Ahead of time, we determine the order of speakers for each question based on that speaker ID, giving equal time to each one of the candidates. Responses will be timed by the timekeeper, Allie Mortland. Wave, there you go. The first 2 respondents will have 1 minute and 45 seconds each to respond. The second 2 candidates will have 1 minute each. Speakers will be alerted via a yellow card when their 20 seconds is left, and a timer bell will ring when the time is up. Candidates, when you see the yellow card, we ask that you be respectful of your fellow candidates and wrap up your thoughts so we can move on to the next question. At the bell, we will have to cut you off. Sorry. Today's moderator is Jessica Blitzek, a member of People Over Party, and thank you and good luck.
To invite each candidate to make a 2-minute opening statement to introduce themselves, starting with candidate number 1 in order on up to number 8. Please remember when you see the yellow card, please remember that you have 20 seconds left.
It's sideways.
Yeah, it will record sideways.
It's broadcasting sideways.
Yeah. Hi. I am Grace Hoff, and I am running for Congress in the 6th District of Illinois. I am an engineer. I have a PhD in mechanical engineering from Carnegie Mellon University. I am a small business owner. I co-own an industrial analytics firm. And I'm a former cybersecurity analyst with the CIA. All of these sound very fancy, and it sounds like I probably have never had a professional problem in my life. I have been fired. When I found out that my coworker was being paid unfairly, I tried to renegotiate to fix the problem, and I was fired for the attempt. It is a hopeless feeling to have to decide between doing the right thing or keeping your job safe. I knew it was a risk, and I would do it 1,000 times over. I am running for Congress because I don't want anyone else to have to feel the way that I did, making the choice between doing the right thing and staying safe. We have so many Americans right now that are scared of losing their health care, of not being able to pay their bills, or getting drawn into another armed conflict. Our Congressman Peter Roskam is making that more likely because he is putting special interests above our interests, and he is rubber stamping Trump's agenda. That's the fire and brimstone portion of tonight's program. The good news is we can do something. This district is going to flip, and a lot of that is based on the grassroots efforts. Thank you. Here we go, yes. This district is going to flip, and a lot of it is because of the grassroots organization's efforts. When it flips, we have the ability to do something to help all these people and ourselves. We have the ability to expand affordable and accessible health care to every American. We have the ability to create jobs for everyone who is willing to work hard. And we have the opportunity to reinvest our budget wisely in more effective and more efficient ways of keeping our country safe.
Okay, I'm going to have to cut you off. I apologize. And I gave the wrong answer. answer to your question, please stay seated, candidates. I forgot about the board.
Okay.
It's going to be a mess if we all stand up, but thank you so much. Okay.
Hi, I'm Becky Anderson Wilkins, and I'd like to thank Jessica, Corey, and Allie. Thank you so much for the work you put into this. I'd like to thank the people over party and also the Coalition for a Better Six. And I don't know if the Indivisible View page was involved in this or not, but
through the coach.
So I want to thank you all for being here and giving up your Sunday afternoon, because I know that all of you care as much as all of us do up here that we have to make a change. So I think you might know me. I am a member of the Naperville City Council. I'm a councilwoman there right now, but I am the owner, I'm the sixth generation of a family business in Naperville. It's Anderson's Bookshop. So if you've heard of our bookshops, you might know me from that. What I do is I sell stories, but I like to tell stories. So I'm going to tell you one that began with us about 20 years ago. Our Naperville store, we heard that a big box, huge store was coming to Naperville. And usually with that kind of scenario, and it was a Barnes & Noble, I tell you. Okay. But when we knew a store like that was coming near an independent bookstore, and I travel around the United States visiting a lot of different stores, but when that kind of scenario takes place to a small independent bookstore, usually they'll have at least a 30% drop in business, or they'll actually go out of business. So that meant for me, well, then we're going to fight, and we're going to fight hard. And we did. And the reason that we did this is that we knew that we had community support. We had a local newspaper that compared us to Have You Got Mail. They actually had Anderson's under Tom Hanks' foot in a full-page ad. So we knew we really had to fight. But what we did is we listened, we engaged, and we served our community. We found out how can we reconnect with those who are our customers and our booksellers. We got together as a staff to think creative ideas and how to listen to each other. So that's how we succeeded. And we did go out of business. We actually had a 7% increase. And that's the kind of fight that I'll take to Congress. But we know that Peter Roskam takes a lot of money from people, and he listens to the wrong people. And I have made a pledge not to take a penny from any lobbyist in my campaign, because we want to listen to you. We don't want to listen to that special interest. So thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Ryan Huffman. Thanks so much for setting this up. It's really exciting to be out here along with fellow candidates speaking to you today. So I'm 31 years old, I live in Palatine, I'm a data analyst. I have lived almost my whole life in the Northwest suburbs, grew up in Elgin. I got a degree from Northwestern in journalism and my master's is in public policy from the University of Chicago. I've spent some time in D.C. on Capitol Hill, interned at the White House. I've interned in President Obama's campaigns. I've interned at a lot of places. And like a lot of my generation, that's really all I can say in terms of success. I'm really impressed by how successful all of my opponents have been in their lives. There are a lot of successful people in Washington already, and I think the voices of people like me who have struggled are not being heard in Washington, and that's one of the main reasons that I'm in this race. A couple of other things that I want to point out, what I stand for and what I'll do in Washington when I get there. Number one, I too have pledged no special interest money, no corporate money. I think we have got to get money out of politics. That's one of the biggest ways to appeal to my generation is to take the money out of the equation. We've got to do that. And I don't think we win this race by being just the Democratic version of Peter Roskam. We win this race by being as different from Peter Roskam as possible. I also want to say that I'm very, again, policy expertise is what I bring to the table. I'm trained in policy analysis. I want to go and be an independent voice, not just rubber stamp a Democratic agenda the way Peter Roskam rubber stamps a Republican agenda. I'm for universal health care, but I don't want to go just to vote for universal health care. I want to go to write the universal health care bill and make it a good one so that we can actually get it done in this country. And last, I want to say the main reason I'm running, the number one thing, for all the ways Peter Roskam has failed this district, I'm running now because I want to get Donald Trump out of office. Peter Roskam is not ever going to do that. He is a coward. He will not vote him out of office. I recommend it.
Because I believe we need a leader that we can trust, who will stand up for us and understands the challenges that many of us go through on a daily basis. Peter Roskin's only concerned about serving himself and his wealthy donors. The clearest example of this is healthcare, and that's why I announced my campaign last May on the same day that Roskin voted to take healthcare away from millions of Americans. I was diagnosed with breast cancer 3 years ago, and my daughter was going through a very serious medical crisis, and frankly, she just went through another very serious one a week ago. So healthcare is very, very important to our family. When I was diagnosed, when I was going through chemo, I found out that our insurance company of 20 years was not going to cover us the following year. My husband's a small business owner. We pay for our own insurance. And I don't mind telling you that I had a tough night and cried on my kitchen counter wondering how we were going to find insurance, would we be able to keep our doctors, and how much was it going to cost. Nobody, no one in this room should ever have to ask themselves those questions when they're going through one of the hardest times of their life. And I want to be your champion for healthcare. I grew up in a very middle-class community. I went to school for 8 years in Speedway, Indiana, a few blocks away from the Indy 500. And many of the people in my community were hardworking members of labor. And if any of them had a medical crisis, they would have gone under. They would have lost everything, including my family. So again, this is why I care so much about healthcare. I am the first in my family to graduate from college. I earned a degree in biology and a minor in chemistry. I understand climate change. I understand what's at stake for our planet. I've also spent 18 years in local government in my own community and know how important it is to listen to people, understand their concerns, and vote in the best way to represent them. And I pledge to do that as your elected representative. I hope tonight, today, this afternoon, that I can earn your support and your vote on March 20th.
I'm standing just for a minute because the people in the back might not be able to see. I wanted to share a little bit about my background because I think my history reflects the history of a lot of people who live in this congressional district. I actually grew up in the south suburbs in the town of Dalton. My dad was a union butcher at the A&P. When I was in high school, my dad lost his job and our family had to sell our house and move to a rental property in Calumet City. I've been working since I've been 16 years old. My first job was at a Wendy's when it was a new chain, so that's showing how old I am. But I've been working ever since. And fortunately, I was still able to go to college because at that time, college was affordable. And student loans, which I had to take out as well as working my way through, were something that you could pay back after going to school. And so I went to college and I also had the opportunity to get a job. I worked for a few years. I got both an undergraduate degree from University of Illinois and then a master's degree in public affairs reporting down in Springfield. Worked for a few years and then I went to Northwestern Law School where I was honored to be the editor-in-chief of the Law Review. And again, I paid my way with student loans. For about 20 years, I was the breadwinner of my family. And then I went in 2008 on a mission to Haiti. With my church. And when you see people in that country and how they don't have the opportunities that we have, I happened to be in Haiti when President Obama was elected, and the people there were inspired. And when I went back, I decided I wanted to get involved. For the last 4 years, I've been the Illinois Chief of Staff to Congressman Bill Foster in the neighboring 11th District. And in that capacity, I've done exactly what Peter Roskam has been criticized for not doing. I have listened to constituents. I have helped them get their Social Security benefits. And I will tell you more later. Thank you.
Hi, I'll do what Carol did for a second and stand to the back and say hello. I'm Jennifer Zordani. I'm running to be your 6th District Congresswoman. I'm running because it's not right what's going on in Washington. Every single person in this room knows that nothing is getting done for the hardworking families in this district. Yesterday, I knocked a door and a woman invited me in. She invited me in to meet her mother. Her mother couldn't come to the door to meet me because she had had a stroke. 61 years old, so too young for Medicare. Her mother was so thrilled to see that Roscom has somebody who's willing to stand up against him. But as she was talking to me, she got emotional and she put her head down on the table. And as she put her head down, I looked at the table. She had a pair of eyeglasses that were taped together. And then when she sat back up again, I saw that the glasses that she had on were taped together. This is a woman who has support from her family. They're a close family. And healthcare and the costs of her medical care are destroying her. It is wrong what's going on in Washington. Absolutely wrong. Peter Roscom is a sheep. He follows the Paul Ryan agenda, who follows Mitch McConnell, and they are not working for the people in this district. I'm a lawyer. I'm not a sheep. I'm very thoughtful. I've spent 23 years working to act logically and to create solutions. And I have to tell you that this is a point in time where it's very difficult for me to be purely analytical, because it's very important to every single person in this district that we create change. I'm Jennifer Zordani. I'd be honored to have your support in this race.
Hi, I'm Sean Kasten. Hello in the back. I'm a scientist, engineer, and clean energy entrepreneur by background. I spent the last 17 years of my career founding and running companies that identified places where industrials were wasting energy, recovered that waste, and turned it into clean heat and power. I did that because climate change is the fact that scares me like none other. And my view was that the best thing I could do was to find a way to build a company that reduced CO2 emissions, but did it in a way that generated enough financial success that other people would hopefully copy us, even if they were motivated only by their own self-interest. I'm extremely proud of what we did. We built about 70 projects, a little over 70, that we installed them all around the world. Every single one met our mission, and last September we sold our company to folks who were duplicating the same thing we did. Then the November election happened. And I found myself represented by a president and a congressman who have access to the same information that I have and have decided to deny it and stick their heads in the sand, pulling out of the Paris Climate Accord, dismantling the Clean Power Plan. My feeling is if Peter Roscom wants to deny these facts on the ground in his district, he should leave the district and maybe spend some time in Houston or Puerto Rico or Miami or Northern California. We don't have a choice about whether to ignore facts that are uncomfortable. We have to deal with them. Roscom has ignored facts beyond way more than climate change. He's voted three times for a health care bill that would cause 20 million people to lose their insurance, that would cause 20 to 40,000 Americans to die. But worse than that, he voted all three times without waiting for the CBO score that would have told him the facts that I just told you. Let's be blunt about this. This is a man who thinks it's not important to know things to do his job. My view is if that's his view, we should help him find another job. He's applying the same approach to tax reform, and we need to fix that. I'm running for office because I think facts matter. I think you guys matter. I know Congressman Roscom doesn't, and that's why I'm going to beat him in November. Thank you.
I got the table leg. Yeah. Hi, I'm Amanda Howland, and I just wanted to make sure I see everybody back there. I've been planting the seeds of change my entire life and watching things grow from all of the things that I've done. I was raised by a single mother in Detroit, growing up in the automotive industry, and I was very, very in tune to what it was like to live with nothing, but to be told that you could get ahead if you worked hard, which is what I did. However, many people in my lifetime, as I was growing up, told me, girls don't need to go to college. There's nothing for you to do. You should become a mother and a wife. I didn't take their advice. I went to college. And because I didn't want any other student or person to be told what they could do with their lives or that they weren't able to get ahead, I originally became a teacher and worked with emotionally disturbed and behavior disordered students. I can make a joke and say they tell me that's perfect for Congress, but it was a passion of mine to make sure that these disadvantaged students had someone who would help them better their lives, which is what I was able to do with mine. When I saw our politicians running amok in our country, I went back to law school and got a degree and became a civil rights attorney so that I could again fight for others. And that's what I've been doing ever since. I'm a trustee at the College of Lake County. I'm in my second 6-year term. I was asked to run for that seat.
I was asked to run for this seat last cycle, and I ran against Peter Roskam and was outspent 30-1, and I got 41% of the vote. And that was knowing I was going to get no help from the federal, no support from anybody else other than the grassroots movement that we put together. And that grassroots movement is growing, and it's because of all of you. And this is the year that we can take the seat from Peter Roskam with your help, and I plan to beat him in November. So I hope that you will vote for me. Thank you.
Okay, this first question is going to go to Pat. What would you do to fix the problems with the Affordable Care Act and to address the Trump administration's recent changes to health insurance coverage and rules? Please stay seated.
I apologize. Oh, no standing. Okay. I wasn't going to come up front, I promise.
No.
All right, my priorities for healthcare in the United States are affordable and accessible. I'm going to hit that over and over and over again. We have a problem right now with the fact that it is not affordable nor accessible to many of us. Peter Roskam has caused a lot of this problem by virtue of the fact that he keeps trying to repeal it. That is roiling the markets. According to both a Blue Cross Blue Shield executive and a Cigna executive, so the insurance companies themselves, are saying premium hikes are going to go up, not just for the public, but also the private markets. The insurance companies are criticizing the instability that Trump and Congress are introducing into the healthcare markets. So what do we do? What we need to do is get a Congress that reaffirms that our commitment to healthcare isn't playing political football so that the insurance companies and every other actor in this market can't get their feet under them and make policies that apply to everybody, they're stable, and have to hike premiums as a result. And lastly, we need to ensure that coverage is affordable by making sure that everyone is covered and getting these risk pools diversified so that the insurance companies don't have any excuse about bringing down the cost. The other component is the federal government needs to help supplement the premiums for those that are going to be compelled to be on insurance, such that they can also afford it too, and this is an undue burden on families and households.
Thank you. Okay, same question goes to Ms. Anderson Wilkins. What would you do to fix the problems with the Affordable Care Act and to address the Trump administration's recent changes to health insurance coverage and rules?
Well, first off, health care is a right. Everyone in this country should have health care, and no one should be left without it, especially a family with a child who is ill, or someone with a catastrophic problem or health issue where it's going to wipe them out financially. I'm a breast cancer survivor. 3 years ago this month, I was diagnosed. I had many complications after surgery, had to switch all of my doctors, switch my hospital, and luckily because of the ACA and the pre-existing condition, I was able to make that switch. But also, too, there are so many issues. The big thing that I really think we need to do with healthcare is that the number one issue between Republicans and Democrats, and that's combining from both sides, 71% of Republicans and Democrats want to see lower prices on prescription drugs. And this is the type of thing we really need to fight for. So many people are paying out of pocket for so many prescription drugs, and the prescription drug companies are controlling the market on many particular drugs where they still hold the patents. We need to work with the drug companies on working on that. Also, to make it accessible for everybody. Everybody forgets that the ACA, that the A stands for affordable. So when Trump takes away the subsidies, it raises the price. It raises the out-of-pocket for the low-income families, and then for the middle class, it's making those premiums even higher. So all of these moves have just been a failure. So we're going to blame this all on Paul Ryan and Peter Roskam trying to repeal. How many times have they tried to repeal and fail? But what we need to do is we need to bring more providers to the market. We need to fully fund Obamacare. I don't even like calling it Obamacare, the ACA. And we need to fight back every time President Trump is trying to sabotage health care for everyone in this country. Thank you.
Do you want me to repeat the question?
No.
Okay.
So Obamacare has a special place in my heart because I spent 2 years on Medicaid, which I was only able to do because of the expanded Medicaid that was a part of that bill. I also was able to stay on my parents' plan until I was 27, thanks to Obamacare. I'm one of the lucky ones. There's a lot of people who have much more extreme circumstances, pre-existing conditions, that sort of thing, that this bill protects. It has problems. and we've seen the potential for barren counties and states where insurers are leaving. Premiums are higher than we expected them to be. So there's a few ways that we can fix it, including a lot of people opt into Medicare at a younger age of 55. Adding a public option would be the number one thing we could do to stabilize the market and to stabilize prices. And absolutely, we need to allow the negotiation of prescription drug prices. Beyond that, I will say fixing Obamacare is great. Ultimately, our North Star has to be single-payer healthcare, a Medicare for All plan. That's what I want to work towards, but we need to be careful and recognize that it's incredibly complicated to get that thing through. We have to be very careful about how we do it. So let's work on fixing the ACA while we keep getting there, pointing towards universal health care, Medicare for All.
I'm going to have to cut you off. I apologize. The timer didn't go off.
The elephant in the room.
Yeah. And again, each question is going to have four respondents. So the final respondent to this question is Ms. Mizdowski.
Listen, healthcare is a very, very personal issue to me, and I mentioned that earlier. I also mentioned that my daughter, we had a healthcare crisis in our home last week. My daughter has a very rare condition. She'd kill me if she knew I was telling you this, but it causes her heart to stop beating for significant periods of time. And we have been told that we have to go to the top specialist in the country for this condition. It's so rare, and it has weighed heavily on me, to be frank. And so I wonder, if she didn't have insurance coverage through her job right now, she's 26, what would happen to her? What's going to happen to people like her that have very serious, complicated illnesses that aren't guaranteed pre-existing conditions? We need to make sure that we have a policy in place that allows every single person in this room to be covered no matter what's wrong with them. And if it wasn't for the ACA, I wouldn't have had insurance after my diagnosis with breast cancer. So I support a Medicare for All public option that would compete with single private insurance company policies. Thank you.
Okay, question two goes to Ms. Cheney. What do you see as the biggest challenge to the rights established under Roe v. Wade? How would you respond to that challenge, if at all?
I have a couple of responses to that. First, the makeup of the Supreme Court is eminently important, and I found it particularly disturbing when the Senate held off the approval of the latest Supreme Court justice because they wanted someone who would vote their way on important issues such as Roe v. Wade. And then there are ways that are cutting against Roe v. Wade at the state level, but also let's take a look just most recently with the health care plans. The current Republican plan is talking about defunding Planned Parenthood, which does not only provide services in reproductive health to women in need of those, but it also helps with family planning, cancer screening, necessary family and women's health services, and they are cutting that from health care. They are trying to chip away at Roe v. Wade in creative ways. And I have to tell you, I have toured a Planned Parenthood facility. When I was working with Congressman Foster, a local facility actually had been the victim of a firebomb thrown at it. And I had the opportunity to tour that facility. And those workers are there every day with their own lives possibly threatened by other people who seek to challenge what Planned Parenthood does. As women, we are entitled to have say over our own reproductive rights, and it's appalling what is going on both at the state and at the federal, and if you look at the state, House Bill 40 at the state level was such a controversial issue this year.
Okay, Ms. Sardani, would you like me to repeat the question?
A woman's body, a woman's choice. I believe the decision a woman makes is between her, her doctor, and her God. And I strongly believe that Peter Roskam is a dinosaur. He is not a supporter of women. I believe we can make our own choices. For Roe versus Wade, one of the things that troubles me about our Republican politicians' unwillingness to talk about Merrick Garland as a nominee is that they had an obligation to vet that judge that was nominated by President Obama. They did not do their job. and that's wrong. Gorsuch, who got put on the Supreme Court, I think is a bad justice because he was very open about his personal political views. He is not an unbiased judge, and we want on our Supreme Court justices that no matter their background will adhere to the law, and women have a right to their own health care decisions. So we have a continuing issue with nominations in our judiciary that the Republicans have held up nominations and they can pack the courts now, and we're going to have to work hard to get a more balanced judiciary again. Thank you.
So I think as several have said, protecting Roe v. Wade is a Senate issue in the House. Unfortunately, none of us here have the opportunity to do that. Peter Roskam this week has said that he is proud to be the descendant of Henry Hyde and the Hyde Amendment, which gives you some sense of how despicable he is. I think all of us here, if elected, can protect the budgets and the funding for Planned Parenthood and those groups. Some facts for all of us to keep in mind. 1 in 4 women in America will have an abortion before they turn 45. That's true for Catholics. That's true for every stretch of the economy. This touches everybody, except we don't talk about it. We don't talk about it in part because we have tolerated this absurd level of misogyny in the White House. And I think the strongest thing that any elected official can do is to stand up and say, I don't care what gender you are, I don't know what color you are, this is unacceptable. This is not the way we live as a country, and if you want to lower the risk of abortion, lower the risk of rape and make access to contraception universally available.
I've been fighting for the Roe v. Wade issues since I worked for the Kerry Edwards campaign, and at that time they had a Supreme Court justice up for nomination too, and we were concerned about what was going to happen. If I'm elected, I will continue to fight every day for Planned Parenthood, for Roe v. Wade, for Personal PAC here in Illinois. I've been a supporter of those groups for all of my adult life. I think that the thing that we really need to do the most is we as citizens need to keep pushing back, holding our legislators accountable, holding their feet to the fire. Roe v. Wade isn't just about women's rights, it's about everybody's rights. You all have the right to control your own health care and your own bodies. Those decisions are yours, and they should be personal. And it's not for the government to jump in and tell you what you should or shouldn't be doing. So I guarantee that I will continue the fight that I have kept up all along in terms of keeping Roe v. Wade, keeping Planned Parenthood.
Okay, the next question goes to Ms. Howard again, rule two. Question three. The current EPA is more focused on removing regulations than adding protections. How would you address this?
We've got to do everything possible to fight what's going on in Washington right now with the EPA. If we don't have clean air and clean water for our children growing up, there's not going to be any kind of environment for them to grow up in. We're destroying our planet by rolling back all of these regulations. And I would definitely work very hard with anybody and everybody who has like-minded ideas to make sure that we put the regulations back in place. And then we look at other things that we can do to build infrastructure for clean power plants, for renewable energy. We, as a college trustee at the College of Lake County, right now, what we've done on that college campus is we've started making all of our buildings LEEDs Platinum buildings. We put green roofs on the buildings. We put in a geothermal field. We're doing everything we can to have renewable energy sources and also to teach the students there about renewable energy so that they can go get jobs in that sector. It's extremely important that we pay attention to what is going on with our environment right now. All you have to do is look at Katrina, look at Hurricane Maria, look at what's happened in the Philippines, look what's happened in Puerto Rico, and look what's happened down in Texas. To know, and look at the wildfires in California. That's all a result of the changing climate and what is happening to our world and what's happening to the infrastructure here. And it's absolutely ridiculous that anybody, and like my colleague said here, Peter Roskam thinks climate change is junk science. It's not. It's real, and we're living it.
Okay. Now the current EPA is more focused on removing regulations and adding protections. How would you address this?
Well, I have to start with the same answer I gave before, that every single senator who voted to confirm Scott Pruitt has blood on their hands. And I don't care how many of them stand up and say we need to hold Trump accountable, they are responsible for Pruitt, for Sessions, for everybody they voted to confirm. The cuts that are going on to the EPA budget, if you talk to staffers in there, are it's painful to realize they're cutting every single science program. The NASA budget has cut funding for NASA to study the planet Earth. We can study Mars, but we don't have a budget for climate science. This is criminal. I will say, having had lots of regulated, EPA regulated and otherwise, energy plants, within the EPA at the staff level, which is the overwhelming majority of staff, there's a recognition that there are tremendous opportunities for minor changes in EPA policies that could make energy cheaper and could make the air cleaner. And when I've talked to people at EPA before about that, they've consistently said, we all know that, but we're nervous that if we open the door to the tent, Dick Cheney might come in. And there's an opportunity for people who have experience and understand those issues to say, you know, there are provisions within the Clean Air Act that discourage energy efficiency. Those are really easily fixable, and no one objects to them, they're just inadvertent. And there's a ton of procedural issues that can be changed. They will not change until we have democratic control of at least two branches. And quite frankly, Scott Pruitt will continue to destroy things as long as he's in office.
Okay, the question now goes to Ms. Anderson Wilkins. Would you like me to read it? This is the 1 minute.
One minute.
Yes, the first two are each 1:45, the second two are 1 minute.
Yeah, she has.
Can you pass the microphone?
Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
Well, I have a daughter who's an environmentalist, and she has worked with NOAA and the University of Maryland on the Chesapeake Bay, working on climate change and ocean rise. And she has created this new position because it's getting all the constituencies, all the different groups around to work together to work on climate change and ocean rise. Her program was going to be eliminated, and we know why, because Mr. Pruitt with the EPA and the Trump administration. Here is a young woman who's so passionate about the environment, has been since she was in third grade with her Rachel Carson puppet for a biography report. I mean, when you think about this, This is a crime that we have so many young people that are passionate about our environment and Mother Earth. Peter Roskam has taken over $360,000 from the fossil fuel industry. So we know who he's listening to. He's definitely not listening to Mother Earth, and he's not listening to any of us. And we got to stop it, because it's the air we breathe, it's the water we drink. We have the Great Lakes, the greatest source of fresh water anywhere in the world, but it's also the ground we stand on and what's happening. And we have to fight, because we don't have this, we're all in trouble.
Okay, Ms. Hack. 1 minute.
Thank you. We need to make this about two things. It needs to be a budget fight and an accountability fight. So I have been cited by the EPA. I did federal level transportation policy research for my thesis. A lot of that was funded by the private sector, but was picked up by the public sector. A lot of my colleagues who worked on climate change were funded by the public sector, by the federal government. We need to fund that research. Second, the budget that was put for the budget guidelines the Senate put out today, they are trying to sneak in a bunch of regulation that undermines the EPA. One of the things in there is that they've opened up the Arctic for the consideration for drilling for fossil fuels. Meanwhile, Puerto Rico, Texas, and Florida are underwater. Peter Roskam has taken, as Becky mentioned, over $150,000 from the oil companies. I can guess where he is going to vote. Accountability, he is trying to make this, paint himself as an environmentalist and saying he's on board with the EPA. I can guess how he's going to vote. So when we talk about accountability, hold your speech to the fire.
Okay. All right, question four goes to Ms. Mazeski. What changes have you made in your personal life to address the impact of climate change? And what actions would you prioritize as a legislator?
Well, I think personal actions, I've done quite a bit for the environment. Most of my adult life, I have done things in regards to teaching conservation classes to students, and currently I lead bird walks for CPS students in the city. I also have picked seeds in a prairie for replanting and creating more open space. I also did energy and environmental policy outreach for the National Obama campaign. I was elected 3 years ago to the Illinois Environmental Council. I absolutely am dedicated to preserving our environment and preserving clean air and clean water. We absolutely have to keep the provisions in place, the protections in place. We all remember when Lake Erie was on fire. We remember when there was smog around our cities. I will support anything. I think it was a huge mistake to pull out of the Paris Climate Agreement as well, and a real slap to our allies. We need to stay on target. We need to drive innovation through a renewable energy technology. We can create jobs. This is a great economic opportunity, renewable energy, and we need to follow this and go with it. Instead, we have an administration that is going in the opposite direction when we have a real opportunity here. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Huffman, same question. What changes have you made in your personal life, and what would you prioritize as a legislator?
So I think it's comforting to think that if we all put energy-efficient light bulbs in our homes, that's going to be enough to stop climate change. It isn't, sadly. We got to make changes at not just a state or local or national level, we got to make changes at a global level. The rest of the world is moving forward on this issue, and we are moving backwards. We are one of the biggest contributors to climate change. So I spent a lot of time when I was interning in the White House. We worked on the cap and trade bill that was before Congress at the time. I was in the Council on Environmental Quality. This is an issue I'm incredibly passionate about. We've got to deal with climate change. We've got to take it seriously. We've got to get back in something like the Paris Climate Accords, Clean Power Plan. It's the biggest issue that we have in our lifetimes right now. We've got to, if we don't deal with it now, we're going to deal with it 10 times over down the road. So I'm in favor of cap and trade. If we can't get that through a carbon tax of $30-$50 per ton of carbon emitted, I won't bore you with the policy details, but either of these things are going to make a huge difference, and that's the kind of thing that we've got to do. Energy policy is one of my most important areas. We have a huge economic opportunity, but more than anything, it's a moral opportunity. We inherited this world from our parents' generation. We're going to pass it on to our children. I want to leave it better than the way we found it, and that's one way to do it.
Okay, thank you for that. Same question, 1 minute. Would you like me to repeat it?
No, thank you. So, as Ryan said, one of the most important actions we can take is to enter into global treaties that reduce environmental impact. And the withdrawal of the Paris Accords was a disgrace nationally. We know that. So we are going to have to re-up our participation in the international community once we have a change in the administration. And that is going to be one of the biggest things that we can do. What I think is very important that we recognize in environmental policy is that we need to reinforce the rules that we have, restore the rules that this administration is decimating, but we did not do nearly enough. That we can have people in northern Indiana who still can't drink their water from the heavy metals from the plants falling down on them. We need to do more with the EPA. We're moving too slowly.
Okay. Ms. Cheney, same question. Would you like me to repeat it?
Oh, no, I'm good. Thank you. I think we need to understand that energy and economic progress are not mutually exclusive. And too often on the Republican side, they try to treat it that way, and it isn't the case. And I have to say, it's fascinating right now, if you look at the makeup of the EPA. I did some searching just to see the makeup of the personnel, and they are former members of the chemical industry. And they are eliminating the scientists who work for the EPA because they are driven by the agenda of special interests. But the real interests are the interests of our society, not only this country, but worldwide. And what's very troubling, and this gets to a larger issue, is when you go back on prior agreements like the Paris Accord, and when you go back on progress that has been made in this country on various issues, it leads to instability and to insecurity. And I think that is the larger issue for this country.
Okay, thank you. Question 5 goes to Ms. Zordani. The president's statements regarding North Korea speak to a perspective that diplomacy is no longer the answer and that the time is approaching for military action. Do you agree with this perspective? Why or why not?
I'm going to tell you right now that you're going to be hard pressed for me to find anything that I agree with President Trump on. President
Trump is decimating our diplomatic corps, and Secretary Tillerson is assisting in that mission. And I don't think military action is going to be the solution. I don't think we should be escalating the crisis that exists in North and South Korea. I think that we need to engage with the international community, and we need to use whatever leverage we have with our other partners in the region, and I would say that China needs to be a partner in that action. So I think that the president has been incredibly short-sighted. I think part of that action that he's taken and his words are because he is influenced by what I will call a military-industrial complex, that there is an inclination to think that it's best if our military handles and we increase our military handles the situation and then we increase our troops across the world. I disagree with that. I think we need a strong military. I think we need to support our troops, but I don't think we need to take action that puts our troops in harm's way and puts other people across the world in harm's way. So I disagree.
Okay, question now goes to Ms. Mazeski. Would you like me to repeat?
Yeah, can you say it one more time?
Sure. The president's statements regarding North Korea speak to a perspective that diplomacy is no longer the answer and the time is approaching for military action. Do you agree with this perspective? Why or why not?
Well, I believe that the first step should always be diplomacy. And diplomacy saves lives. Let's be clear about that. So right now we have a president who's stoking the fires with North Korea, and it's unforgivable the games he's playing right now. It's so irresponsible as a leader of our country. We need to be putting pressure on North Korea. We need to be working with our Asian Pacific region allies and coming and putting more and more pressure on them. The Iran nuclear deal came after 5 years of sanctions on that country, followed by 2 years of diplomacy to get the Iran nuclear deal. This takes time. Four administrations before Trump have worked and have been dealing with North Korea. So this is a hard issue, but make no mistake, it's a dangerous issue. So we have to work on applying continual pressure on the country and working with our allies in the region.
Okay. Ms. Cheney,
first of all, I have a problem with governance by tweet. When you are bullying and threatening other countries by tweet, it is simply irresponsible, especially when you do need to be looking at possible solutions on a diplomatic scale. But again, this gets to the larger issue with the current president, and that is the instability that the current administration has brought to this country. I call it a game of whack-a-mole, because every day it is something different. And I have to tell you, when I was in the congressman's office, we were getting so many phone calls from constituents on a daily basis concerned about the issue of the day. And the concern with President Trump isn't just his position on this, but it's that we don't know what his position is from day to day. And sadly, Peter Ruskin does not call Donald Trump out on that. He goes lockstep with Donald Trump. 97% of the time, he is voted with Donald Trump.
I'd like to catch up. And Ms. Anderson Wilkins, same question. Would you like me to repeat it?
Is this 1 minute?
It's the 1 minute.
Okay, 1 minute.
Well, I think the first job of any congressman is to keep our citizens safe, and that's here and abroad. And I think we do have a president that's pretty much having a Twitter fight with everybody. And it's not only our enemies, but it's also with our allies. And to have this kind of Twitter thing is immature, but it's also, this is supposed to be the leader of the free world, but yet he's doing this stuff on Twitter. It is absolutely ridiculous. But he's pouring gasoline on fires in hotspots, whether it's Korea, or whether it's the Iran nuclear deal, because when we get out of these deals, or even with the Paris Accord, when we get out, we're losing our status in the world. That means that our enemies will not agree to anything, as well as our allies, which makes it extremely difficult. But I think, too, we have to think about, even nationally and locally, what we need to do in this country to keep ourselves safe. And that's cybersecurity, and that's looking at a lot of different things with gun control, but also how we deal with homegrown terrorists and those who are being affected, and how guns are available to put into people's hands. So it's not just internationally, it's also nationally.
We apologize for the nice. We're trying to change it. We cannot. Thank you. So question number six goes to Mr. Huffman first. Is Congress doing enough to prevent foreign interference in future elections? What needs to be done?
The easy answer is no. They're not doing nearly enough. Right now, we're in a place where the President of the United States only cares about what makes him look good or gain more money or more status for himself. He will not take action to deal with the interference of Russia in our election simply because he thinks it'll make him look bad, like he didn't win the election fairly. This is the President of the United States. His words have consequences. His actions have consequences. And as long as he is staying in power, our democracy is threatened. So what does Congress need to do? I certainly am not an expert in cybersecurity, but it's pretty clear that we need to be doing more to protect our elections. And there are good people around the government working on this issue. They need the support of their president to do that. They need the support of their Congress to do that. And as long as they are not getting that support, we continue to be at risk. So again, that's what I said this before. One of the main things, the main thing I want to go to Washington to do is get Donald Trump out of office, and the congressmen who are enabling him, who are apologizing for him, who are defending him, they've all got to get out of office too.
Okay, Ms. Haas, same question. Is Congressman enough to prevent foreign interference in future elections, and what needs to be done?
Absolutely not. So I'm glad that I finally get to talk about national security and cybersecurity. I have been cleared, I have to get my statements cleared by the CIA if I'm going to make any statements. I have had it cleared that I'm allowed to say that it looks like the Russians have compromised the integrity of our election system. It was a propaganda war. We haven't proved yet that they did or did not interfere with voting systems, and we haven't conclusively determined whether or not they managed to sway sentiment of the American public. I can look at all this evidence, and my personal opinion is that they did. Putin took a page out of his playbook that he used in influencing the UK about the Brexit vote. He influenced the Ukraine, and now he got the US as well. What we need to do about it, to fight these propaganda wars that the Russians are incredibly good at, we need to disallow, that's the important part, disallow money, dark money in advertising that is going to the tech companies that isn't traced like all of our other campaign money is traced. All of our statements have to have a slug on the bottom that says paid for by Grace Hoff for Congress if I take money and put out advertising materials. The tech companies are media companies that need to be regulated as such when we are making political statements to fight the propaganda. Second, Ryan started to mention this. We need to fund the intelligence, State Department, and other agencies working on cybersecurity. We are not putting enough attention to that right now. It's not just a cybersecurity war in terms of propaganda or on the internet. It also is going to come down to the fact that North Korea, if they were going to try and compromise our national defense systems, the only way they can reach the American continent right now is to hack into the systems, open floodgates in the plains of Iowa and flood towns, for example, on the Mississippi. That's a lot easier for Kim Jong-un to do than to launch a nuke at the West Coast. We have to beef up these technological defense systems, and that requires funding and personnel.
Thank you.
So there's a kind of a simple game theory piece here. If you as a country seek to take another country's land, we have a whole host of multilateral agreements, the Geneva Accords, all sorts of war rules that make it very clear that there is a multilateral world order that responds to that. Our information at this point is more valuable than our land, and there is no equivalent multilateral framework to take our information. We crafted the rules for war, such as it is, with countries that had a vested interest in stability. Russia has a vested interest in instability. There are a lot of countries, including China, who have a vested interest in a stable world. And there's a place for a multilateral framework to say we need to develop rules for essentially cyber warfare that make very clear what the consequences are for action. We can't really do that unilaterally. And we certainly can't do it when we have a president and a Congress that seems to be cozying up to Russia, North Korea, Iran, countries that do not have a vested interest in stability.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Zardani, same question, 1 minute.
I want to be a little bit careful about when we're talking about the Russian influence in our elections. There are absolutely some discussions about the propaganda wars. We're a free speech country, okay? So we have to be cognizant that we let foreign people speak to our U.S. people, and that's not going to change. The issue that we're seeing that people are not talking enough about is the disparate rules that apply to the large technology companies. And Facebook and other large technology providers received an exemption from certain advertising requirements. And the time has come for that to change so that consumers and readers know who's pushing that information to them. It also is a fact that our current president seemed to be unaware of the effect of the Russians seeking to influence his campaign. We have to recognize, more to follow.
Okay, we do get away with the elephant. Question 7, education. What do you see as this goes to Ms. Necessity first. What do you see as the federal government's role in public education? In your answer, please address specific issues such as charter schools, Title IX, testing, or school nutrition.
Well, I believe that anybody who, so this is about education at all levels, correct? Charter schools. I believe that anybody who wants to go to college should be able to go to college, and I think that every student in our country should be able to get an excellent education regardless of their zip code and where they live. And it is up to our country to ensure that. We need to stand up for students, and we need to stand up for educators. We need to make sure that our schools are teaching them the skills that will allow them to succeed in the 21st century. They need to be able to live up to their full potential as a human being. And that's why education is so important. And I believe in funding public schools to the maximum amount. And this will help remove the disparity that goes on in our country. I also believe that we have to make education affordable for everyone. And when I talk about giving people the skills to succeed, I mean whether they want to go down a path to a four-year university, or they want to go to a technical education school that will provide them with the skills for 21st century manufacturing. So those are the important things I care about education. We have to keep funding it. We have somebody in charge now whose first name is Betsy, who seems to be going in the opposite direction and seems to care less about the students. And that really concerns me.
Okay, thank you. Now, Mr. Kasten, same question. Would you like me to repeat it?
No, that's fine. Let me start with K-12, and we'll see if there's time for the rest. The number one, I think all of the evidence is that what you learn at an early age impacts you for life, and the older you are, the less ability you have to really change the direction you're on. Universal pre-K is a no-brainer. I love Governor Pritzker's proposal for that. I think more broadly, everybody should, of course, have a choice about where to send their kids to schools based on what they like to do. But I don't think government's role is to make choice easier when it comes to education. For so many of us, your elementary school, your high school, is unfortunately the last point in your life when you are surrounded by people of every socioeconomic level, of every religion, of every color, and it's formative. And you look at the places that have really embraced community choice, and we've developed this sort of complete schism of the country. We need to make sure that the public education system we have at K-12 level are as good as they can possibly be. And if people don't like them, that's okay, but let's not keep funneling people out of those systems. On the higher education level, I think it is a tragedy that people with student loans, number one, don't have the ability to refinance those loans at current rates, and number two, can't get out of those loans through personal bankruptcy. Nobody wants to go through personal bankruptcy, but this is just a weight around way too many people. And there's too much evidence that people are avoiding higher education because they can't afford it or they don't like the financial risk. I will leave more time. I reserve my time for the floor.
Okay, Ms.
Hoff,
same question, 1 minute.
Thank you.
I'm going to start with K-12 and then I'll go on to higher education. So from the K-12 perspective, public funding for education is the most important investment that we can make in this country. I grew up in Iowa originally, and I came here to the Chicagoland area when I moved to go to Northwestern. I didn't realize what a great school system that I had the luck to go to in public school in Iowa until I moved to Northwestern and realized that there were kids from the East Coast in private schools that were playing a whole different league than I was. I almost had to drop out because I was taking on a lot of loan debt. So I needed that public school to get me to Northwestern, and then I needed the loans to get through Northwestern. It is critical that we not have those opportunities taken away from our students by privatizing student loans to the degree that we have. We've made it a for-profit industry, which means necessarily those interest rates are going to go up and they're going to be impossible for our students to pay back. The federal government should be running the loan program at a sustainable and non-profit rate, not at the private sector rates.
Okay, Mr. Huffman, same question, 1 minute.
So first of all, I think Grace said it perfectly. Education is one of the best investments we can make in our country. Right now we're seeing such huge disparities in outcomes over the course of a person's life based on their early childhood education, their primary and secondary education. We've got to invest more and we've got to level the playing field. The difference in an education that somebody gets in New Trier School District in Wilmette versus one somebody gets in Chicago Public Schools in the south side of Chicago is staggering. And these kids don't have a chance if they don't get more funding. We've got to stop teaching to the test. I'm totally against that. And I'm totally against any robbing of public public education coffers for charter schools. Briefly, I want to touch on student loan debt. I've got six figures of it, so I know what this is like. The government can't be profiting off of the backs of the students. They need to be encouraging people to get more education and doing whatever it takes to make sure that that happens, not punishing them for doing that.
Okay, thank you. Question 8 first goes to Ms. Zardani. You are all running in the Democratic primary. There are many opinions on how Democrats can best win elections, from move center and appeal to working class conservatives to move left and draw a strong distinction between Democrats and Republicans. What do you think is the best way forward for the Democratic Party as a whole?
I don't think we need to move much at all. I think the Republicans have made clear that they don't have a vision for their party anymore. They used to talk the talk that they're fiscally responsible and want small government, and now we recognize that they want no government, that they are beholden to the Koch brothers, so they want nothing to do with government. They don't want government to function effectively. Democrats have always wanted government that helps people, helps lift people up from lower income, gets them into jobs. We want to create job growth. I think we need to stay focused on our fundamentals. I was talking to Comptroller Mendoza this morning, and she has a debt transparency bill going through the Illinois legislature. And she made clear that the Republicans have increased $2.8 billion of spending that is unauthorized spending, and it's not known where that comes from. We know that the Republicans abuse their position. And as Democrats, we need to start talking about the fact that we want good, effective spending, because when we make the best use of our dollars, we serve the most people. I think we're all really agreed on a lot of the same issues. So we believe, I know I believe healthcare is a right. I want to get to the place where we give quality, accessible, affordable healthcare to everybody. And we all recognize, and I think especially that we recognize these issues are complicated and we want to work hard to get there. We want to protect everybody in our community. So I think we have to stay the course, make sure that we're not making these choices about
Thank
moving.
You.
Okay.
Ms. Howland, same question. Would you like me to repeat it?
Please.
You are already in the Democratic primary. There are many opinions on how Democrats can best win elections, from move center and appeal to working class conservatives to move left and draw a strong distinction between Democrats and Republicans. What do you think is the best way forward for the Democratic Party as a whole?
First of all, the Democratic Party has to unite. We have got to get a message and we've got to be united. That's how the Republicans continue to win, and we need to do the same thing.
I was talking with Congressman Adam Schiff at an event just a few days ago, and he said one of the things that we really need to do is we need to make sure that we're telling people what we stand for, what we're going to do, not just what we're against. And he said that message resonates. Another thing is we have to continue with the progressive movement and with the grassroots movement. And progressive doesn't mean moving way to the left. That's not progressive. Progressive means looking at things like single-payer health care and affordable income for everyone, I mean a living wage for everybody. It means bringing people in to the system and helping those who need help. And Democrats, we want to include everybody, but we haven't done a good job with messaging and getting everybody out and getting everybody involved, because we have a tendency to scatter too much or to focus too much on everyone, the other side's negatives. So I believe as Democrats, we need to sit down, talk to each other, unify behind causes, and then get out there and fight for those causes with a cohesive message that we all are on the same page, and keep pushing a progressive agenda.
I think pretty clearly from the Bernie Sanders wing of the party. That being said, I actually voted for Hillary in the primary last year. It's a little secret for you, but I don't think we need to decide which way to go or the other, but we do have to rally the base. That is the most important thing. The differences between the two sides of the party right now are about process, and what it really comes down to is authenticity. Who are you fighting for? Are you fighting for the individual people, the people who are struggling? Or are you fighting for your wealthy donors and corporations and the people who have the most money that therefore have the most say in government? So I think on issues, we're all in the same place. We all want to get there to more progress, a more just world where the economy works for everybody and not just those at the top, where money does not have such an outsized influence in politics, where we're dealing with things like climate change and getting to universal health care. We all want to get there, and I think the key to doing it is appealing to people in an authentic and genuine way and doing it free of influence from.
Thank you. Ms. Cheney, same question.
Somebody used a quote that I thought was very telling. They said, Martin Luther King didn't say, I have a strategy. He said, I have a dream. And I think a lot of times the Democrats, and perhaps Hillary Clinton in her campaign, said, I have a strategy, but she didn't talk about the American dream anymore. And the Democratic Party was built upon the American dream and the dream of opportunity, that if you work hard, you'll be able to achieve whatever that dream is for you. And it seems that the party has gotten a little bit away from that. We're not talking the economic base that we used to talk to. And that economics, it can be advanced manufacturing. It can be teaching children in our schools the critical and analytical thinking skills that they will need for the jobs of tomorrow. It includes our economic security in the form of the ACA, because our health care is an important component of all of our economic security. But I do think speaking economics is vital.
Can you hold on to the microphone? You're up for the next question. All of these questions were assigned randomly through the numerical system. Every candidate has a number assigned to them, and they each have the same number of speaking opportunities and speaking length of time as well. So that's why it's bouncing all over the place.
How long did that take you to do?
I did not have to do that. I would like to thank Allie here and Eric Hastine over in the audience. Okay, question nine, Ms. Cheney. Many people think that if gun safety legislation didn't pass after Sandy Hook, then it never will. Do you agree? What needs to be done?
I think we need to be able to look at gun violence as a public health issue. And unfortunately, more than a decade ago, it was decided that the Centers for Disease Control could no longer receive government funding to assess strategies for gun control prevention as a public health issue. So then what happens is whenever a crisis occurs, such as in Las Vegas, such as in Florida, wherever, we look at the patchwork solution and whatever seems to be the problem of that day. I think there are certain
solutions that have been discussed on discrete issues. But until we're able to assess this as the public health crisis that it is, we'll never be able to get a comprehensive plan of action, which at this point is what this nation needs. It is the third leading cause of death among children and adolescents. Is that what our country should be? So we talk about, for example, selling at gun shows and getting rid of that loophole. It's a small portion of the gun violence deaths. Let's look instead, for example, at stalking. And someone who has a misdemeanor for stalking can still buy a gun. And there are so many thousands of gun violence incidents against victims of domestic violence in this country. But again, until we can study this in a rational and common sense way, we will not be able to get a comprehensive program and we'll only have piecemeal suggestions after the latest tragedy occurs.
Thank you. Ms. Hatt, same question. Would you like me to repeat it?
Sure.
Okay. Many people think that if gun safety legislation didn't pass after Sandy Hook, then it never will. Do you agree? What needs to be done?
I disagree. It will be passed eventually. It requires elected officials who are willing to unequivocally stand up to the NRA's special interest lobby. So the Las Vegas shooter legally acquired automatic weapons. No, you do not need an automatic weapon, unequivocally, period. It's too bad that this is even controversial. That being said, so come back to the NRA. Yeah, you guys have a lot of money. You're making this issue very extreme. Fine. I'm telling you right now, I am not trying to steal all your guns. I'm not against hunting. I grew up in Iowa. I know people that hunt. My sister one time didn't break up with a guy during deer season because she didn't want to lose her line to deer jerky. So we can have conversations like this where I'm saying, it's fine. I'm fine with the hunting. But no on the automatic weapons, period. End of story. We just can't keep ceding this ground to a false moral equivalency.
Well, Grace is right. The thing is, Roskam has taken over $41,000 from the gun lobby. And when you think about it, he's also very proud of his A rating with the NRA. So good for him to get an A. Yeah, we love that. But you know, when you think of 273 mass shootings since the beginning of the year, that means a shooting where four people have died, and that doesn't include the shooter. What does it take to make this stop? I don't know. We can't go through another Orlando, another Las Vegas, another whatever it is. But background checks, you know, we talk about even the state of Illinois has the strongest gun laws in the nation of any state. But yet, we have so many people being killed in Chicago, and 60% of those guns that are being used in those violent crimes are coming from places like Indiana, where the gun background checks, you don't even need one at a gun show. So we're experiencing stuff like that. But we need to ban assault weapons, those military type weapons that the shooter used in Las Vegas. And how is he allowed to buy multiple guns on that level from so many different sources? How can that happen?
Thank you.
So that's what we need to do.
Ms. Musetsky, same question, 1 minute.
This is a very frustrating issue. The other thing we didn't talk about is the shooting at the baseball game in Washington, D.C. with the congressman. Really, what is it going to take? Immediately, my reaction is to contact your elected officials and never let up. Because the Republicans, the gun lobby, you know, is very, very strong in Washington, D.C. But the one thing that is interesting is that 92% of Americans agree that we should strengthen criminal background checks. And 87% of Republicans also agree with that. So one thing we can do to keep guns out of the hands of violent criminals, domestic abusers, and potential terrorists is to stop the gun sale loophole and make sure that anybody who's going to buy a dangerous weapon at a gun show, on the internet, or through a classified ad in the newspaper has to go through a criminal background check. And also I'd like to add that if you can't fly on a plane because the FBI has you on a no-fly list, why on earth are you able to buy a gun? So we need to ensure that.
Thank you.
Okay,
Mr. Kasten. Question 10 goes to you first. Mr. Kasten.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Dark money, gerrymandering, voter suppression. These are some of the elections issues our members are concerned about.
What do you consider to be the biggest problem in the election system today, and how would you work to change it?
So here's the thing that I find massively depressing about the job that every one of us up here wants to get. Everyone up here has ideas about what they would do to make the country better, you know, big plans, good legislative ideas, and I think that's true for an awful lot of Democrats. If the first order of business, if I had a wooden table in front of me, somebody knocked wood for me. If the first order of business isn't figuring out how to get us back by 2020, well, knock wood that we get Democrats in control, to be at a point in the 2020 election where we have at least as much confidence in electoral integrity as we did in October of 2016, we're heading towards anarchy if we don't solve that problem. This thing that Trump has unleashed, that elections are fake, that they're being manipulated, that a lot of people have contributed to, I mean, personally, I think I almost feel like we need something like a Truth and Reconciliation Commission that says, you know, not just what did Trump know, but what the heck did Dana Rohrabacher know, and when did he know it? Grace had mentioned these CIA reports. There's public CIA reports that say there is no way that the Russians could have had the information they had about the election without having some access inside congressional campaigns with vote builders. That may have been done inadvertently, but if that's not the number one priority to figure out where that is and get us back to a point where the majority of Americans have confidence in the electoral system, we're in a bad way as a country. And we gotta be public about what we know and give people an incentive to come forward and say what they know and clean up the mess.
Thank you.
Well, I agree totally about fixing the problems with the election and tampering and everything, because if we don't fix this, we don't have confidence in our elections. So we need a president that stands behind the process in the right way. But the other thing about voter suppression, in many states, and a lot of them are down south, we have many people that have been denied the right to vote, just trying to get to the ballot box. They've been denied that. And what's great in Illinois, we passed, once you get your driver's license, you are automatically registered to vote. That's what we need to have in every state. There's no reason that someone should have to bring in an ID card, even if they're not a registered driver. I think we need to do that. In many, many places where there is a Democratic minority, there's much suppression going on by the Republican Party. And this happens in a lot of places. We need to make sure that our elections are fair and that everyone who has the right to vote can express that right. And I think we do also have to reach out to young people to make sure that they're registered. Many kids who are in high school will be 18 by fall of November of 2018. There's a whole series of voters that are possibilities that we have to make sure they vote for that first time in their lives, vote for a presidential election or vote for the midterms. And we know that Democrats are notoriously bad about getting out during the midterms. So I know all of you are gonna vote, but work on every other Democrat that you know, because we have to make sure that the process is fair and safe. But we also have to make sure that we get people out to express that right to vote.
Thank you. Ms. Mazeski, same question, 1 minute. Would you like me to repeat it?
Yeah, repeat it one more time.
Sure. Dark money, gerrymandering, voter suppression. These are some of the elections issues our members are concerned about. What do you consider to be the biggest problem in the election system today, and how would you work to change it?
Well, I think they're all very important, but I am concerned about dark money. I think that right now our voices are all getting drowned out by wealthy corporations and wealthy individuals. We all know who the Koch brothers are in this room. And our voices are not getting heard. And so what I'd really like to see in a perfect world is a Supreme Court decision to overturn Citizens United. But realistically, until we get control back in Washington, D.C., that ain't gonna happen. So right now I would say that we have to lobby our congressmen and women, and we also need to, one thing we can do is push for transparency with super PAC money and force people to list who they're getting their money from. We could do that through Congress. So again, we have to get back some control in order to make some of this happen. But that dark money is one of my top concerns.
Thank you. Okay, Ms. Holland, same question, 1 minute.
Making sure the mic's on.
the dark money bothers me immensely. My current congressman actually voted in favor of extending Citizens United so that money could come in from overseas and get funneled into accounts here and then funneled to people who were running for election with no accountability whatsoever, so that you didn't know where the money was coming from. Fortunately, that did not pass. I think one of the biggest issues that we have right now in our government is we don't know where the money's coming from and who's funding it. Even though we do have regulations, they're not being enforced. There aren't enough regulations. We never were intended to have a government that was of the wealthy, by the wealthy, and for the wealthy. That's not what this country was founded on. We need to get back to the principles of honesty and openness and making sure that there's accountability and transparency, get the money out of politics so that people that are involved are not unduly influenced by these outside groups, and that's going to be the biggest issue.
Okay, thank you. Question 11 goes to you as well, Ms. Howland. What needs to be done to expand the shrinking middle class?
Lots. First of all, we have to get rid of the people in Washington who keep trying to give tax breaks for the top 1% or top 0.1%. They keep telling you that it's trickle down, and I'll tell you, I heard many times from Al Franken that trickle down economy doesn't work if you're at the bottom because you're too poor to have a boat, so all boats don't rise. The other thing that is happening right now, and now I lost my train of thought. What was the question again? I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. What needs to be done to expand the shrinking middle class?
Expand the shrinking middle class, yes. Okay, sorry. The other thing we need to do to expand the shrinking middle class is we need to start looking at what the jobs are going to be in the next century, because we're moving away from all those manufacturing jobs and all those coal industry jobs. That's not where this country's going. And we need to make sure, like we're doing at the community college here, that we're providing training for those types of jobs so that students can go on when they graduate and get a job that's going to pay them a livable wage, but it's also going to be a job that's going to be there for a while, as opposed to trying to look at jobs that have already left us, because we're not going to get those back. We need to do more partnering with businesses to get apprenticeships for people so that people can learn a skill and then go to work for that business through an apprenticeship that doesn't cost them an arm and a leg to get the training that they need. So I think expanding the middle class is going to be stopping these crazy tax cuts that are only going to help the top percentage, looking at ways to make health care affordable, and getting the job training that they need.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Houston, you can have a question.
So this is an issue that I'm focusing on a lot on this campaign. I'm talking about we need to build a new economy that works for everybody. The middle class is being left behind right now. 95% of all new wealth generated in this country is going to the top 1%. That's inexcusable. We've got to do better than that. So there's three pieces I want to do to make this economy work for people. The first is empowering our workers. Right now, the employer-employee relationship is way out of whack. We have got to strengthen our unions. We have got to expand collective bargaining rights to more industries. One of the best things we could do is universal health care. If you don't have to worry about losing your health care when you lose your job, suddenly you've got a lot more power to demand more from your employer, or you'll just leave and go to another business. So that's a key part of it. The second piece is empowering consumers. It wasn't that long ago that you could get married, start a family, buy a home, and do it all on one middle-class income. That is not the way it works anymore. We've got to get back to that. And a big piece of that is cutting down on the size of these massive corporations that look at you just as a number on a spreadsheet. If they lose your business, they don't care. So why do you think you have such terrible customer service from Comcast and AT&T and Verizon? Everybody hates these companies. They are too big. We've got to get them down to size. We've got to get back to a place where our neighbors are running our businesses, and they have to treat you with respect, and then you'll treat them with respect as well. And then the third piece of this is infrastructure. It does not make sense to me that there are so many people unwillingly out of work in this country when we have so much work that has to get done. These two things should cancel each other out. It's not happening right now. We need a massive investment in our crumbling infrastructure. A lot of this stuff hasn't been touched since the 30s when it was built to begin with. We need to take a page from FDR's book, invest massive amounts in this infrastructure, in bridges. It'll be better for everybody. Your roads will be better, your bridges will be safer, and people will be going back to work. So that is how I would strengthen the middle class.
Thank you. Thank you. Request your 1 minute.
Two pieces. First, we are in a period of transition economically, and we have been for a while now. We have the jobs in a lot of fields that are growing and will be growing for the next 5, 10, 20 years. It's a matter of making sure that students and other workers understand what the jobs are and then have the ability to get trained for them. At the federal level, this means funding retraining programs that already exist better at the College of DuPage, at North Central, and a lot of the other programs that we have in the 6th District that already exist. Second, coordinating our high school to post-secondary to jobs pipeline. A lot of high school students don't know what type that the union jobs are available. They have good jobs for you, but they don't understand what programming a CNC machine to do technological manufacturing is. So making sure that our federal education policy is including a piece that is exposure to industrial tech and a lot of the jobs of the future. The second piece that I want to make was Peter Roskam's budget. Sorry, you'll have to talk to me later about the taxes.
Mr. Jackson, same question, 1 minute.
Thank you. So I disagree with Grace on this, that we have the jobs. And this is the massive problem that I think people know but don't talk about. As a country, if you look at job creation trends for the last 30 years, we've been really good at creating high-skilled jobs. We're really good at creating low-skilled jobs. We are not creating medium-skilled jobs anymore, and the bulk of the population are medium-skilled people. That's why we have so many H-1B immigrants coming here to fill a supply-demand graph. That's why we have the nativist tension from people who've been kicked out of their jobs on the top end. That's a hugely hard problem, and every single person in this room is in some degree responsible for it because we love the convenience of the kiosk at McDonald's and WebMD and all of the things in our, you know, our company. We provided utilities to companies that employed 6,000 people. 10 years ago, they employed 60,000, and they made half as much stuff. Those factories are really cool. A lot of people lost out in the transition. Historically, we've solved that through innovation. That's a bit of a cop-out answer because you don't know if that'll work again, but don't cut science budgets, my God.
I have to cut you off, sorry about that. Okay, question number 12 goes to Ms. Anderson-Wilkins first. The United States is divided along many fault lines, including race, religion, gender, orientation, income, and country of origin, some issues dating to the very founding of this country. What needs to be done?
Well, I think the biggest thing, and this is interesting, I just read a book, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and the book's coming out in November, and it's talking about his career. It's called Becoming Kareem. And being an African-American, you know, he's a sports legend, but it's also when he grew up, he lived in a housing project that had people of all kinds, and he didn't actually realize that he was black until he reached about fourth grade and he got bullied at school. I think it's so important that we recognize people as people. And in my business, that's something that I've done repeatedly, is getting diverse books in the hands of children. We have to start them at the very youngest age. So kids can see themselves not only in books, but they can see themselves in their culture, but also so they can learn about other races, other cultures. And that's where we've missed the boat. There's a whole movement to get more diverse books out into the world. And that's something we really have to do. If we start with our youngest children and we teach them that people come in all colors, shapes, and sizes, and that we come from all different backgrounds, all different religions, all different cultures, it is so important. It's so enriching that we have these things. I got a welcoming type proclamation through our city council just a couple of weeks ago because that stated what we are as a city, that we accept everyone of all kinds, all races, all backgrounds, all sexual orientation, everything. It is so important. And I think we can all work harder because if we think we don't know somebody about somebody, and when you feel you don't know somebody, you feel a little bit more reticent to get to know them. We have to make that step forward to get to know people of all colors, all backgrounds, because our lives will all be richer for it, and it'll make our country so much stronger.
Thank you. Ms. Kareem, would you like me to repeat it?
I think I'm good.
Okay.
Some of this starts at the top. And unfortunately, since Donald Trump took the presidency, we have seen incidents of violence against people who might look differently than we do, or have a different religion than we do. We've seen that violence increase, and we've seen people being drawn into the shadows. And without a leader at the top who is setting the example for us, it is difficult as a country, and it's important that we keep grassroots movements like these growing to express our views. But I think it's the sort of thing that you also do need to reach out to your congressional representative, and I can give you one tangible example. When President Trump came out and didn't criticize the neo-Nazis in Charlottesville, Peter Roskam did not criticize President Trump for that failure until constituents from the 6th District called his office, criticized him on Facebook, and basically made him do what his conscience should have told him to do in the first place. Unless we reach out individually and collectively and tell people our views, those views won't change, but the most important thing ultimately is have elected representatives who represent our views in Congress.
Thank you. Okay, Ms. Howland, same question, 1 minute.
Well, you're right, it starts at the top. We've become a country now that instead of embracing all as our founding fathers did, we're now pointing the finger at everybody who's not exactly like us. That is 100% wrong. We need to get back to the foundation of our Constitution and of our preamble to the Constitution and of the notion that all men are created equal, not just men, women too. We are more alike than we are different. And if we talk to each other and reach out to each other, we realize that there's a small faction that's trying to cause this country to become very divided again, and it's absolutely criminal that it's being allowed to happen. I was at a great event just a week ago in Naperville at a mosque where they had an open mosque day. I still have some of the henna tattoo on my hand. But they had people from all over come in and see the mosque and taste the food and tour. And those are the kinds of things that we need to keep doing so that we all understand how much alike we are.
I'm going to catch up. Thank you. Okay, Ms. Zordani, same question, 1 minute.
I am very much a believer that we need to ourselves take responsibility for our words. And I'm going to say that I'm certain there are people in this room that when an issue has come up that's been pushed out by what we would call typical somebody Republican, people may have commented, oh, those Christians, okay? We ourselves have to recognize that Democrats aren't perfect either, and we have to start doing more to stop attacking people for their religion. Making generalizations about race or economic status. We can do better ourselves, and then we can reach out to our friends who are on the other side of the aisle and let them know that they can do better as well. I think that division is not necessarily always a party issue. It is something that comes from individuals.
Thank you. Before closing statements, we have time for a lightning round. So Allie's gonna choose a number randomly. Once she sets the timer for 10 seconds, you have 10 seconds to answer the question. And the question is, please tell us what one trait, attribute, or experience makes you more qualified than your opponents here to represent the 6th district. Everyone will answer the same question. Yep. What one trait, attribute, or experience makes you more qualified than your opponents here to represent the 6th district? First up is Ms. Mazeski.
Oh. healthcare. Because of my personal healthcare story and the crisis our family is going through right now, I care deeply about healthcare, and that makes me more qualified.
Thank you. Next is the
top. Oh my God.
Ethics. So I know what it costs to do the right thing, and I did it anyway, and I do it 1,000 times over. I know where that line is, and I know how hard it is to find it and make that choice. I've done it, and I'll do it again.
Thank you. And Ms. Anderson-Wilkins.
Well, I think being a bookseller and being a small business owner, what I've done to connect people with different ideas all across the political spectrum, all across ideas, and talking face to face to talk to people to agree and have open conversation. That is one of the greatest joys in my life.
Thank you. And Ms.
Persistence. I like to dig into an issue. I like to analyze it with a compassionate perspective, and I want to work hard for the people in this district.
Thank you. And Ms. Howland?
Hard worker. I've been working for you for several years, since I started running in the last cycle and now running again this cycle and in all the events that I'm involved in and everything that I do every day for people.
Thank you. Ms. Cheney?
I'm a fighter with shared experiences. I have had to work all of my life for everything that I've been able to achieve, but I understand your experiences because I share them with you.
Thank you. And Mr. Kasten?
Because I refuse to accept that there's trade-offs. This is a district that is highly educated, that votes Republican because they're pro-business, whatever that means, but is socially liberal, and that's what I've spent my whole life doing.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Huffman?
Policy expertise, integrity, and passion. That's your thing.
All right. Thank you. So we'd like to now invite the candidates to make 1 minute closing remarks addressing any other issues you'd like to discuss. Since we started 1 through 8, we'll close out with Ms. Howland and travel down 8 to 1.
1 minute.
1 minute. And please stay seated. I apologize.
Oh, okay. I just want to see the people in the
back. I know.
Okay, 1 minute. I've been fighting for this seat last cycle, 41% of the vote, outspent 30-1. I was told by Senator Durbin and others when they asked me to run last time that you have to run more than once in order to beat an entrenched incumbent. So I'm doing what they all did and running a second time. I've built the network, I've built the experience, I've got the momentum going, we've got a movement. All of you are welcome to be part of it if you're not already. This is a seat we can win. This time around, we can win the seat, and I will fight every day for health care, for education, for a livable wage, for not getting us involved in other wars, and for not getting us, or for getting rid of the president that we currently have and putting us back on a path to prosperity and civility.
Thank you.
So, I think there's been a ton of good ideas here. We're all very fact-based because we're all nerdy Democrats. Let's not lose sight of the moral issues here. Nobody should have to use a calculator to answer the question whether it's a good idea to have Nazis and racists in the White House. No one needs a spreadsheet to know whether anyone should be able to tell a woman what to do with her body other than that woman. And you don't need to do a discounted cash flow analysis to figure out whether our generation has an obligation to leave a better planet to our kids than the one we inherited. The only thing you need is a moral compass. We don't have a moral compass in the White House. We don't have an elected representative who is willing to do anything but encourage it, if that is narcissism. We need to get moral people back into Washington who will make that a priority. That means getting Roskam out, and man, do I look forward to kicking his butt in the door as the door slams on him on the way out. Thank you.
Gun reform issue, and we mentioned that the current incumbent has taken money from the NRA and he has an A rating. And I'm going to tell you that that matters to us, but I don't think that actually matters to him. What we see is a representative who has no leadership skills. We are looking at tax reform where he has not fought for the people in this district. He put up a tax bill that doesn't allow you to deduct your state and local taxes. We know in this district that matters. He's not fighting for the people in this district. He doesn't represent the region. He doesn't fight for individuals. I want to get in so I can fight for the families in this district and grow business in this district. Thank you very much. I have a petition at the back. I have cards at the back. Please sign for me. You can sign for all of us. I very much appreciate your support. Thank you. I think we just have a wonderful district.
I think we need some someone who has the qualifications to hit the ground running when they take the seat, and also can be viable in the first place to win the seat from Peter Roskam, because that is our number one mission. When I was in law school, I was the moot court champion at Northwestern Law. Peter Roskam was the moot court champion when he was in law school. He needs someone who is able to call him out, because on WBEZ earlier this week, he portrayed himself as a moderate. He does that repeatedly. And we need someone who will research the issues and explain why he is not a moderate and why he is not who he says he is. I've been endorsed both by Congressman Bill Foster, Congresswoman Robin Kelly, but what would be most important to me is having your endorsement in the election. Thank you.
I'm the only candidate up here who has been raising the resources necessary to win the primary and go on to the general election. And it's something we don't talk about a lot. I've received 1,100 individual donations to my campaign, which is something that I'm very proud of. In addition to having the resources, I have a top-notch team that can go the distance with Roskam and is already laying the groundwork to victory in the primary and for the general. And I want to say we have a lot at stake right now. It's very obvious from everything we've been talking about, but we don't, and we have an opportunity here. So it's important to elect the right candidate to win this primary. I want to be the person to sit across the table and ask Peter Roskam why he voted to take health care away from 23 million Americans. I think I can win this election. I can't do it without you. So today I'm asking you for your support and for you to visit my website, KellyMazeski.com. Thank you. And your vote on March 8th.
Thanks so much again for having us out today. I think we've got an amazing group of candidates here, and I think after the primary, if we all band together, Peter Roskam doesn't have a chance, and I look forward to that. I just want to say briefly, I think that this is an incredibly important race. Our democracy is under attack right now, but I'm still very, very hopeful in this country. And I think my generation is ready to stand up and start to create the world that we believe we should have. We know what this country is capable of, and we want to make it great again. Not in the way Trump does, promise you that, but we want to strengthen the middle class. We want to deal with things like climate change. We want to give health care to everybody. These are the things that we're going to work on in Washington. It's time for new leadership. It's time for new voices in D.C., and that's what I want to do when I go. So thank you.
I think if I treated my customers and my businesses the way that Peter Roskam treats the residents and the citizens of the 63rd District, I would have been out of business decades ago. Because we know he's too worried about keeping his job and not doing it. And that's the biggest thing. I also think all the things that he's done, whether it's health care or his total failure on gun safety or DACA, immigration, he listens to lobbyists, we all know that, to the tune of almost over $500,000. Also, his backroom tax plan, not reform, really bothered me. To have a room full of white men, all Republicans, and not include a single woman, really bothered me. My idea is that I want to engage, and want to serve, and I want to build the community. I mean, that's what I've done as a bookseller. I sell empathy through books, and we sure need a lot of more empathy out in Washington. And I hope to earn your support, but I'm really dedicated to making this a better place for the 6th Congressional District and our country.
Thank you. The theme of my campaign is do something, and so I'm going to channel JFK here for a second and say, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. So we're doing something up here. We're running. The grassroots organizations have done a phenomenal job of getting people off the bench to mobilize to spread the danger of Roskam's message and his votes to the people. A lot of this is an information campaign. We're going to flip this district because people are paying attention. So here's what you have to do. I need you to vote. I also need you to tell 5 friends to vote. This is your role in doing something. We can do something besides just yelling at the internet. satisfying for about 4 seconds. So vote, tell your friends. We are more likely to vote if somebody we know, one of our neighbors, tells us to do so.
And I've heard a lot of people say, well, I think the whole system is corrupt. I don't know what to do. I wanted to burn to the ground because this is pointless. Yeah, change is hard. I know. This is a huge monumental task. What I'm finding resonating with people at the farmers markets is, if you don't make the choice, someone else will for you.
Definitely go vote on March 20th. Thank you.